Hi, I'm Larry Dapsis. I'm the entomologist with Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. And in this segment, we're going to discuss the ins and outs of pet protection. I'm with Dr. Catherine Brown from our State Department of Public Health, and she is our state public health veterinarian. So, Katie, good to see you again, and welcome.
It's really nice to be here, Larry. Thanks so much for inviting me.
And as you know, as part of our overall protection program, you know, we have a three-part plan: protect yourself, protect your yard, and protect your pets. And I've talked with hundreds of pet owners, and for me, one of the observations I've been making for several years now is a lot of people care more about protecting their pets than themselves. So let's run through from the top, you know, the type of things that our pets can get.
Yeah, absolutely. So, as you know, in Massachusetts, the tick that we worry most about is the black-legged or deer tick. Mm-hmm. And that can carry Lyme disease, babesiosis, anaplasmosis, and then two other diseases that we don't really worry about for pets: Borrelia miyamotoi and Powassan virus. Mm-hmm. But so for Lyme disease is the one obviously that is most common in Massachusetts in people, and it's also the one that's most common in our domestic animals, our pets. And so for that, we know that dogs definitely get Lyme disease. It's relatively common to see that. Mm-hmm. Cats have been shown to be, in the laboratory, we can infect them, but kind of in real life, they don't tend to get Lyme disease. And that may partly be because they're so good at grooming themselves.
Yeah, they're like little possums. I mean, they're Rambo of the tick world.
Exactly.
And because people in general, I never hear about cats and Lyme disease,
right,
but in pooches, I hear about it all the time.
Absolutely. And we can't forget about horses. They get it a lot, and actually goats do too.
Really?
So there's some information in the literature that show that cows can even get Lyme disease, but again, I think the animals we really worry about are dogs, horses, and goats here in Massachusetts.
Okay, very good.
And then just briefly, we can talk about babesiosis and anaplasmosis. So those cats and dogs can actually get both of those. And then horses are pretty susceptible to the anaplasmosis.
Okay.
There is a babesiosis in horses, but it's caused by a different organism that we don't seem to have here in Massachusetts.
So as a pet owner, responsible pet owner, what's the first approach? Is it, you know, talking to your veterinarian perhaps?
Yeah, as a veterinarian, I think that really is my recommendation. You know, I think there are a lot of options for protecting our animals, but it depends on what kind of animal you have and then, you know, sort of what type of exposure they have to the outdoors. So maybe first what we could do is talk about dogs and the Lyme disease vaccine.
Okay, so what would be the options that if I wanted to protect my pooch adequately, what do we do?
Yeah, so I mean, I think if we want to do protecting them adequately, what we talk about is Lyme disease vaccination, which is, you know, very effective. It does need to be boostered regularly, so it's not just a one and done type of vaccine, but that can certainly help protect your dog against the disease. And then the other thing, because there's really no single thing that you can do, so the other thing that's helpful is to talk with your pet about using a tick repellent type product for your dog.
I've had a number of people tell me that they get oral drugs from their veterinarian. What's the scoop on the oral drugs?
So let's talk about the fact that there's like this spectrum of products that are available, and the oral products are definitely one. And those tend to be products that you have to get through your veterinarian. They have some benefits in that they generally also tend to protect pets against intestinal parasites and sometimes heartworm. And so there are benefits to those oral products, but they're not the only thing that's available.
Sure, we've got an array of over-the-counter.
We do.
And it seems that today, right now, the mainstream products are these monthly topicals like Canine Advantix 2.
Absolutely. So when you're talking about sort of topicals, there's actually three groups. So you could start with, like, we have shampoos, sprays, and mm-hmm. dips that you can use on your animal, and you do that. Most of them last about a month. But you're right, the more popular ones are what we call sort of the spot-on treatments, and it's where you take the product and administer it directly to the skin on the back of the neck of the animal. the way those products work is that they actually get absorbed into the skin and then are distributed throughout the subcutaneous tissue that occurs right underneath their skin, and then get re-excreted out through the sweat and oil glands.
Yeah, I think for most people that putting it on one spot and it magically is distributed,
yeah.
But that explains it quite nicely.
Exactly, and so, and those are, you know, they're very popular because you only have to do it once a month. They provide very good protection. And in fact, there's now one particular brand of collar which actually has the same mechanism, and
sure.
You know, you have
Seresto.
That as an example here. But again, they all work using that same mechanism, although they have slightly different active ingredients.
Now, Seresto, you can put that on cats and dogs, but something like Canine Advantix too, you have to really pay attention to the type of product and the active ingredient, just because Canine Advantix too contains permethrin.
Yeah, I really appreciate you bringing that up. So a lot of these products are available just over the counter, and it's totally appropriate to purchase them that way. But I really, really strongly recommend that people talk to their veterinarian first, mm-hmm. and get advice about what's most appropriate for their particular situation. As you mentioned, the pyrethroids, any of them, are actually relatively toxic to cats. And so you need to be careful when you're using those products. You want to make sure you're only using them on dogs. And then you also need to think about the type of contact that your cat and dog have and whether it would pose a risk to your cat.
Sure. And the next level of protection is the fashion industry has gotten into this.
Absolutely.
There's a number of companies that have products that are impregnated with permethrin.
Yep.
This is Insect Shield. It's a neck gaiter for dogs. There's bandanas, there's t-shirts, and there's like hunting vests.
Yep.
So there's just a whole host of things that are out there available to help protect our.
Well, you and I have talked about sort of permethrin-treated clothing in people for a long time and about how effective that is. So it only makes sense that that's something that we consider for use on our dogs. So again, this is a permethrin product and they're not appropriate for use on cats, but they can be very effective in dogs. I just want to mention one more thing, and again, it gets back to sort of stressing this, the importance of talking to veterinarians, because, you know, all of these products use different chemicals, and any chemical, natural or otherwise, has a potential for some side effects. They're rare, but they do happen, and there are certain situations where you need to really be more concerned, more careful than others. And, you know, we particularly want into people who have very young animals, very old animals,
sure.
sick animals, or animals that are pregnant or lactating, you know, nursing young. We want to make sure that, particularly in those situations, that you talk to your veterinarian before you use any product.
And if you do purchase a product, the important thing for everybody is that read that label. It
right.
contains a lot of important information, and these products, EPA registered, the label is the law. So there you have it. There's a wealth of information available on how to protect your lovable pets. So with that, stay tick safe.